Hey everybody, thanks very much for coming out to the Clark Art Talks lecture series. I'm really excited to introduce our artist tonight, Ralph Pugay. But right before I jump into that, let me just say thanks to the ASCC for the generous funding for the lecture series. It really helps out a lot. We have a couple more lectures coming up in winter quarter, and I hope you guys have all seen the Archer Gallery exhibit downstairs, the poster show Hasta Siempre. It's really, really good. If you haven't been to that, you should go do that. Ralph is a very accomplished painter, and he's done a lot of things that are pretty impressive, including he's a graduate from the Skowhegan School of Painting and Drawing, Painting and Sculpture. He's a Joan Mitchell grant recipient. He won the Betty Bowen Award and had a show at the Seattle Art Museum. Like, all this kind of like big deal stuff, right? But that's not the main reason that I like Ralph's work. I like Ralph's work because he's, a lot of artists pretend to be funny and like act like their work is funny, but Ralph's work is hilarious. And it actually like, it pushes boundaries and is weird, and yet is still like always has this little bit of kind of witticism that I am always excited and find very unexpected. And I'm really excited that he's here to share his work with you all tonight. So please help me welcome Ralph Pugay.
Thanks, Grant. That was great. And also thanks to Sensony and the rest of the faculty here at Clark for inviting me to lecture. I guess whenever I lecture, I always start out with a conglomeration of these images of like paintings that I've done in various years. When I think about painting, obviously like I really like painting in a singular sense, but when I think about my work, I often also think about the context that it exists in, and more often than not, that's like a gallery context. So I also always think about like the experience of like looking into a space and seeing like the entirety of the content that's in there. And for the most part, it's like I like creating experiences where it's a bit tangential, like the various images that exist like on this page. But like for me, the thing that connects them together is like, I think the images that I'm really attracted to are like images that I would define as like part of like a globalized type of vernacular, things that like we all are sort of familiar with. So it's like, in terms of my background, I grew up in the Philippines, and over there, you end up seeing different types of media. So the Philippines was colonized for 3 centuries by the Spaniards, and then 10 years by the Americans, and then 3 years by the Japanese. And so like you just see kind of like a hodgepodge of different things. So when I was growing up, I would watch Chinese melodramas, Mexican soap operas, Ninja Turtles, MacGyver, all of that stuff in combination with the things that the country was producing. And so in terms of that, it's like the scope of media that I was digesting was kind of diverse. And so it's like, that was like my scope, like basically like the space in which like I was like thinking about like, I guess like what it means to like live as a global type of citizen. I was gonna say something else, but now I'm forgetting. But I guess it's like, for me, when I think about these things, it's like they're really about like the experience and confusion of living in such an interconnected type of world and the things that we digest in that world. So growing up in a Philippine province, like the first things that I end up seeing in terms of like art was like religious reliquaries. The country is like 80% Catholic, and you also see art like this, like murals of people sort of like coming together and doing things that are very active. Let's see, why is it not moving forward? Oh, let me try this. And then things that I'm also attracted to are like sort of these images. So it's like locating a type of history of like global miniature narratives, I think is really interesting to me. like this idea, this like, oh, like all over the world, like there's like this tradition of people creating images of miniature people interacting with space. So I guess maybe going back to that, how do you go back? So there's like the Ramayana, like Egyptian hieroglyphs, Japanese block prints. There's also like these ex votos, which I'm really interested in because it's like they have like such a ritualistic component to them. So basically a lot like people in Latin America would commission an artist to like paint one of these if they believe that like God saved them from a particular type of peril. So in this case, this guy was saved from like falling off a building, and then this guy was saved from like being eaten by an octopus, which I think is just like hilarious. Also interested in like thinking about like petroglyphs and like how people sort of start dissecting like signifiers. Like when I think about like this type of image, which is like a petroglyph in Utah, like I start thinking it's like how do people sort of start thinking about like animals being separate from like the nature that they exist in? And then it's like, how do we like learn to categorize, maybe, is like a larger question that evolves out of that. And then there's like an English hunting painting. And when I was teaching in Virginia a couple of years ago, their museum had a bunch of these, and I was just like so fascinated by them. And you know, now that I think about it, I think the reason why I like them is because it's like animals are such a prominent part of the scenes all the time. And so it's like, in a scene like this, it's like, it's so idealistic, but you see sort of like a power relationship happening amongst like different types of signifiers, like people and animals. And then there's like these, you know, like masters and peasants. Just really interesting stuff. And then there's this one that I came across more recently, which is like a rendering by an artist from North Korea of how they thought living in China would look like, or how living in China would be. I guess this artist just kind of like assumed that there would be like parades going on through cubicles all the time or something. But for me, it's like, I think this image is really attractive because it's like thinking about like the political conditions in North Korea and how like maybe like it's a somewhat like repressive type of society. Like there's that space where people are able to sort of like activate their imagination as a place of like autonomy. So it's like you can be enslaved by somebody, but you can always have your imagination to sort of like escape that. And I think that's like a really powerful idea for me. Another thing that I've been looking at is like this artist, Fernando Amorsolo, who's like a Filipino painter. And he was painting in like the early, well, 1900s, like 1900 to like 1950s, I would say. And I'm like really interested in how subversive these images are because like, so it's like at that time, the Philippines was just getting out of colonization and from the Spaniards. And he was painting these like images of like, this kind of like somewhat like exoticizing to women. But I think like the thing that I gravitate towards is like the idea that it's like the male gaze in art and like Orientalism in art for the most part is like a very Western convention. And in a way, like he's kind of like adapted that convention and creolized it so that he can take ownership of like his own sort of like sense of nationalism, which I think is like pretty profound. I don't really know how to like translate that to this, but I guess it's like for me, like a little bit of a background. So it's like I didn't start painting until I was in graduate school. And at the time, like I was really interested in just kind of like making work, but like, for me, I was more interested in just trying to depict images based on memory without like a representational source. And like, it started out quite rudimentary. So it's like, I would paint like really simple structures, squares, rectangles, but like the way that I would compensate for like that lack of ability would be like creating tricks, like putting something in the margin that could then like allow you to sort of like just stick with that image for a while, and kind of like figure out what's really going on. And also like thinking about that, like thinking about like the space where it's like you're sort of lacking this privilege of like mastery maybe. I don't know. Like I started thinking about like things that you might not have or things that aren't in your horizon. So it's like I had a friend who was at the studio in grad school at the time, and I was like, Steve, just make a list of, make me a list of things that you know you'll never ever do in your life. And one of them was like making love to a shark. And I thought that that image was really gripping, so I just decided that I would paint Steve making love to a shark. And then this was like also an earlier painting. It's like I was like really interested in like, I don't know, like just pop culture facts, I guess. And like at the time, like I was curious about this idea of cryogenics. Which is basically like bringing, I guess it's like bringing people from the dead or something. I don't know. But like I was thinking about this artist Anna Mendieta, who allegedly was pushed out of like a building by her husband Carl Andre, who was also an artist. And I was just thinking, oh, like what if Anna Mendieta came back from the dead, but like she still had revenge on her mind, and but she wanted to start her art career at the same time, and all she can think of is like revenge, and so she would make like really bad revenge knife art, and people would wouldn't show up because they thought that it was terrible. But it's like when I think about my work, it's so much about like thinking about like taxonomy and syntax. So when I think about, when I look at this painting, it's so much about like just collecting everything that reminds me of church, and then sort of like mistranslating that and like reorganizing the structure of that convention in order to create new meaning out of it. And that goes for a lot of the work that I do. It's so much about like just kind of like creating something that's familiar, but reorienting things in a particular way enough to like create a sense of like wonder for me when I'm looking at it. At the time too, it's like, I don't know, it's like before graduate school, I was feeling this sense of complacency. I was watching a lot of Power Rangers and reality TV and Sabrina the Teenage Witch. But like when I look at like these types of images, it's like it's so much about like narratives that seem to be part of narratives that are like that. It's so much about like conflicts and like winning and losing and like people collaborating and being at odds against the environment in which they're existing in. So I find them to be very attractive, and I often wonder why people are compelled to like watch these types of programming. But probably because like catastrophe, based from my own experience, oftentimes gives you an adrenaline rush or like kind of like wakes you up from like whatever it is that you're thinking about. And so like it made me think about anxiety a lot in relationship to like these things like that a couch potato would watch or something. And so it's like at some point I would just like create my own catastrophes. I would like make game-based catastrophes, like pretending to have a stomachache in public. So I would the game would be like faking us like dropping to the ground to fake a stomachache, and then when somebody stops by and asks if I'm okay, then I would slowly say I feel better, and then I would walk off, and that would be the game. And then I created like my own sort of like reality TV show stunts or like obstacle courses So at the time I was going to physical therapy for chronic pain, and I was in graduate school at the same time. And at the time I was like, I don't know. It's like, I'm just so busy because it's like I'm working too. And there's so many things going on, and like there's really no time to just kind of veg out. So I just created my own reality show, but like the parameters were based on like executing physical therapy stunts. And like through the execution of those physical therapy stunts, there would be something in the obstacle course that would allow me to paint. So in this case, it's like I have like these rings that are attached to my shoulders, and they would then stretch my shoulders. And in the process, those rings would be attached to a pulley that's like swinging these candles that would pour candle waxes onto those pieces of paper on the ground. And in this case, I would be doing the cobra, and there would be like a mop head that's attached to my chest, which would then paint onto that piece of paper that's attached to a lazy Susan. I was also doing these like graphs, like these living graphs. In this case, this one was called Race of the Races, where I would like plant the same, like the seeds all the same way. And what would happen is at the end of the exhibition is like whichever plant that's categorized with that particular race would win. And then in terms of categorization, like I think this was in 2008. I was like, there was something in the news about pot legalization. And I was just thinking about like the commercialization of pot, and if there was like, you know, if there was a pot mall next to a Best Buy or something like that, what would that pot mall include? And so I just came up with everything that I could think of that's related to like pot culture, but not really, because it's like, I mean, I don't know, like there's like a section where you can pet cats, like a rock climbing section, like a hookah bar. There's like a woman here that's like my favorite, because she's like, she's dancing with a snake, but this is a buffet. There's like rappers up here, and people are really into it. But for the most part, it's like, I think for me, painting's like most interesting when I'm like just kind of like trying to extend my abilities a little bit. And in this case, for some reason, a lot of my work relies on language games. So I would come up with a phrase and then figure out how to visually literalize it. So in this case, I was sleeping one night, and somehow I just had like this like weird phrase come up in my head, which was wave butt. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. Like, what could that possibly be? And this was my best attempt at like trying to figure out what wave butt would look like. And then a lot of them is like just about like exercising, like really basic drawing and painting exercises, like trying to transform a man, like an animal to a man, and then like creating a story around that. Or like transforming a monkey into like this guy in a suit, and everyone at home's like really excited for him to come because they're playing Jenga. This one, I like play on words a lot, and this one's called Sports and Medicine. But I love like scenes where it's like people are just taking the same course of action, and like they're exemplifying the same types of like affects, like emotions that where you don't necessarily understand where it's coming from, you just know that it's there. And then a lot of the work too becomes like super allegorical, which I think is influenced by having been raised Roman Catholic, and like, you know, being familiar with Proverbs. Like when I think about this painting, I often think it's like, oh yeah, this story is totally about how it's really hard to, even if you're in a really weird situation, oftentimes it's really hard to express dissent with that situation when you're in a big group. I I often think about my work in terms of like a lot of situations where people are employing misguided certainty. Like they're just in stressful situations all the time. And so it's like they're just reacting to things. And it's like this would be like a very overblown sort of depiction of that, where it's like these doctors are saving these beavers with like a commercial airline jet. But it's like thinking about like misguided certainty, like I feel like it makes sense now. It's like I have a friend who was just like talking about this idea. It's like, yeah, misguided certainty is like really about being an artist. Like when you're an artist, you're like misguided all the time. You're misguided in terms of like not knowing what your future is gonna be like. You're misguided in knowing whether your work's gonna have an effect on anybody. You're always kind of like just unsure, but it's like you have to exhibit a sense of certainty in order for you to actually make any, make anything at all. This one's called Young Lovers. I guess for me too, it's like about complicating the experience of like understanding how we understand people. And sometimes art for me is just like about kind of putting things together and like being really subconscious about like images that seem really interesting to combine. It can be as easy as that, but then there are times when it becomes like super loaded, like this one where these sweatshop workers somehow have found out that telekinesis is possible. And so while they're doing leisurely things, they're controlling people or robots that are working at the sweatshop. I like these circular ways of thinking, like where, these dogs are ordering from like a cash register, or like this person behind the cash register, and so they must be sophisticated, but they're ordering fast food, so they can't be that sophisticated. And at some point, like eventually I started working on these and I started getting like ideas from people of like things to paint. And this is one of those cases where my friend Jason wanted a painting of a mermaid giving a lecture. And for me, it's like I was totally open to the idea, because I think for me, it's so much about filling the gaps of like filling information. Like, okay, I have that phrase, like mermaid lecture, like what goes into a mermaid lecture? And then from there, it's like it becomes a trigger to sort of like expand your imagination in a really interesting way. This one's called Spiritual Microwave. Like so much of my work is about not knowing how anything works, but like just kind of taking a chance that, you know, it's doing something. I don't know what I was gonna say about this one actually. But I think for me, it's like, I mean, a lot of this stuff's like really biographical. Like, I mean, when I think about this painting, it's often about like complacency and knowing that, oh yeah, like there are trials and tribulations, but are you gonna focus on that? But it's like, I guess for me, it's like the question is like, what are the limits of that, you know? Like, what are the limits of like the things that you're willing to let go of, like willing to endure, and like, what are the things that you can't let go of? This one was a story from a friend who was walking at the cemetery, and I guess like the idea is that this woman had her husband die, but they met at Starbucks, and so now she brings him Starbucks to his tombstone every time she visits. I guess for me, it's like this one's like, I don't know, I like scenarios to kind of convey that sincerity can exist in like the weirdest places. This one's called Old Spice All the Time. I think I wanted to make a painting that I could sell to like a business, like Old Spice. But I don't think they're into it. But I guess for me too, it's like, you know, thinking about this, it's so much about buying things that we like, but also maybe buying into things as a way to sort of like feel a sense of belongingness to something. And so it's like the object, like consumerist objects, like operate in a very complex and visceral way. I don't really know how to talk about this one either, except for I had a friend who came up to me at an opening and told me that he knew what this painting was about. Like he was describing to me that those lizards are on that woman because they're cold-blooded and they needed a place to be warm. But I was like, Walter, yeah, but why is she naked? And he didn't have an answer to that. Like, this is like another sort of like cognitive loop where, like, obviously these students are doing something problematic, but then the nun is like wearing designer underwear. And so it's like, how do you sort of like figure out like where to place your judgment on anything? I like moments that look really sincere and like I had a conversation with somebody about this where it's like, well, you know, I'm like really interested in like this idea of like the aesthetics of sincerity and like if we can tell just from like looking at someone or listening to someone that they're telling the truth, then is the truth like replicable in its aesthetic form? Like, is there a way that is like you can convey that? And my friend was like, yeah, it's called lying. This one's called Dogs Barking at Weapons. This one's called Chicken. I'm gonna go fast through some of these because I don't wanna miss out on time. But the story behind this one is basically, you know that thing where you're like planning something with people and then something bad happens and then you have to ask yourself whether you should do it anyway or not? Like, this is totally about that. This one's called Chicken Pox Orgy, where like these people have like organized an orgy, but they all got chicken pox. And it's like they're trying to figure out, well, they've already established that they were gonna do it anyway, and this is what the orgy looks like. A lot of calamine lotion. I think like working in academia, so I teach too, and like I think like it's always really interesting to me when students sort of like make subject matter about homelessness and sort of like thinking about how automatically when you're like thinking about those students, you automatically get invested in their subject position as artists and conveying that subject matter. But I think ultimately there are moments when sometimes I just want to paint people eating tacos from a dump truck. And I think I just have to give myself permission to do that. This one's called Wake Up, Baby. Oftentimes I think about like these scenarios where it's like it's large bodies of people working in synchronicity. In this case, they're like in this sort of like really nice line on the way to shake babies. Here are some prisoners that obviously escaped, but you know, in the process of escaping, they come across a spiral jetty in Utah, and they're like, "Hey guys." I'm like really interested in like things that feel like they're concrete, and then trying to figure out how to dissect that either through like a concept or through like depicting form. In this case, it's like I often think about this as something about your physical presence and like the way in which, like, you know, when I've had like a day job in an office or something, you have to hold a sense of decorum, and how like you basically change your body and like sort of like interacting with space in a natural type of form. And so I think this is like a more sort of like absurdist like version of that, where it's like literally like this person is like coming back home to his own body piece by piece. I was at this residency, and some of the residents were just feeding this. There were a lot of spiders there, and some of the residents were just feeding the spiders popcorn. And I was really fascinated at the way that those spiders were eating popcorn. But for me, like, I'm really into like this idea that like this kind of depicts like different universes that are all part of like the same body. And then it's like, I don't know, I'm also like, you know, I often use in my work, I often use isometric projection, which ends up like kind of cutting up a lot of the spaces in these geometric types of forms. And when I look at this painting, like I often think about like its relationship to abstraction, or like modernist abstraction specifically, and how at that time it's like so much about like modernism is about like denial of like the atrocities of like the world wars, and like trying to come up with new isms to live like a better life, or like enact a better ideology for living life as a collective. And I like the idea that it's like about, like in terms of my work, it's really about questioning that and like asking questions as to like what is concrete and what isn't. I feel like this is so connected to this, like this idea that is like the universe is so vast, but and in that universe there are so many different worlds. Like in Rothko's there are so many different colors, but it's like we can look at them the same way, or we can look at them differently depending on how you want to view it. I don't really know. I guess for me, like, I don't know. Maybe I'll skip talking about this one because I'm running out of time and I have more slides to go. Is that okay? So here are some BDSMers, like, falling from the sky. I like the idea is, like, it's so much about, like, pain. And like, but it's like the wrong type of pain, you know? It's like, so it's like, are they having fun or are they not? And then like at some point I came across this guy, Wilhelm Reich, who was like an inventor, and it was like, a student of Freud's, and then eventually like moved away from Freud to start his like own sort of practice. And he was like considered a sexual heretic in America, and his books were burned, and he was in prison, and he died in prison. But he had this idea that like your chi, your life energy, is something that also exists in the atmosphere. And so he was like creating these inventions to suck the orgone, which is the life energy he was talking about, from the atmosphere. And like the cloud buster that he invented, oddly enough, was actually able to grow grass in Joshua Tree in the desert, which to me was like just really fascinating. But I was thinking, it's like, well, if life energy exists in the atmosphere, then maybe like part of the life energy that exists in your body could also possibly evaporate. And then maybe that's how evolution happens, is different life energies just kind of like mixing it up in the atmosphere. So it's like there's like these different life energies that are being sucked up into the sky. And then over here, it's hard to see, But it's like these faces are basically like creatures that are turning into like half person, half dog. They're combining. I'm like really into like these sort of like motifs where there's like an eruption and then a repression of that. This was a billboard I installed called Baby Coughing Politely. And I just like, yeah, I just wanted to create a billboard where it's so much about like the release of something primal and then it becomes sort of like civilized just through one simple gesture of like a cough pocket. And like talking about that, this is another painting that's so much about that, like an explosion and then like an inward sort of like interference. Oh, that slide did not turn well at all. This was a painting about like going back to like this idea of chi or like life energy and like how we sort of like kind of contain it, because it's like we have to live within a capitalist type of system and we can't just rage out. I was thinking, oh, like what if this person had like an internal combustion of life energy, but the life energy ended up doing the same thing that he was doing at work anyway, which was reshelving items that have been misplaced from the grocery store. This one's called Cattle Rave. And I only put this one up because I've been trying to do this project of like trying to make Cattle Rave into reality. So the idea would be to like bus people out into the fields with a bunch of cattle, and all you see in the dark are these glowing bodies, basically. And then we bus back. But that hasn't happened yet. But I'm also like really interested in different ways of like perceiving things, and like because we're becoming more and more technological, it's like, you know, it's like linear perspective was like a Western type of convention, right? Like that we use to like convey space, and now like we have like infrared to convey something else, like geothermal heat. But like, I guess I'm kind of wondering is like, how would we see things in the future once we have things that are implemented into our bodies to see things in a particular way? And how would those things look like? Thinking about like bodily functions too, it's like, I've been really fascinated by this idea of like muscle memory, that you kind of like contain trauma into your body. And like that becomes sort of like, they become like neuroses, or they become like physical pain. And I was thinking like, well, if people have that, would snakes also have that? And I was just trying to come up with various ways I was trying to come up with different things that could possibly be traumatic to a snake. And I didn't come up with like very much. Some of them are far-fetched actually, like a volcano. or worms, like why would that be traumatic to a snake? Cigarette butts. I like this idea that it's like these like wrappers are coming out of this statue that I think was influenced by like all of these statues that I was seeing or just passing by every day when I was living in Richmond, Virginia, which is like the Confederate like capital. They have like all these beautiful statues of all these bad people. And then this like, there's like this animistic entity that exists in the Philippines called the Kapre. And I guess for me it's like just really interesting to think about like animism in relationship to like industrialization and how like certain types of rituals end up connecting people. And we also have the rituals of like driving in traffic, and like I entertain the idea that that also connects people, but just in a different way. This one, like I just wanted to paint something that reminded me of like back home, so I painted this one. It's called Frying Butterflies. Like trying to cook something up that's completely insubstantial. And this one's like a more recent one. I just wanted to paint like a water park because it, to me, the water park conveys like natural forms, like, and it like it's like such a contained space to sort of like experience adrenaline, which you probably would experience if you were just out in nature, being chased by a bear or something. But in this case, it's like I was really interested in this idea of creating this setting that then becomes like the place for sort of like this guy to sort of like contemplate suicide, maybe. I don't really know what he's doing, but he kind of looks lonely to me. And then I had this dream after like a really intense massage that was like a lucid dream that lasted for 3 days. And I, like in the dream, I was in a mansion for 3 days. And I was just walking around, and like in there, they had a hot tub lined with cocktail shrimp on ice. And I was just like really fascinated by that concept, so I figured I'd make an image of it. And then paintings have also taken like sculptural forms. How am I doing on time? Yeah, 10 more minutes? Yeah. And this one I'm not gonna talk about too much, but it was basically a performance at an exhibition that I had of like a Power Ranger type of figure doing Power Ranger stunts on paper mache objects. And then after gutting those creatures, inside of those creatures, there would be ingredients for hors d'oeuvres. And so he would then go on to proceed to make hors d'oeuvres and put it in the microwave and then run off. And then this is another project that I've done recently. Like I'm really interested in this idea of like collapsing luxurious types of experiences, but thinking about it in a way that is also collapsing with like post-traumatic design or something, like things that exist after a calamity and you just have to rebuild really fast. And like, how does a luxury space, like sort of, how can that be integrated into a place like this type of place at the bottom? And then I've been part of a collaborative group called Fuck Mountain, and we've been doing just different things that I feel like kind of are somewhat related to my painting practice, but like we installed this sign that just said free iPads on the window of this gallery, hoping that people would harass the gallery for free iPads. And then this one I'm not gonna play to like for very long, but it's basically an imitation of severe turbulence in an airplane in a classroom. So there's that. And then we had an 8-mile hike to Hooters that was like the first annual Veterans Day hike to Hooters, which was started out at Colonel Sumner's Park, and then we ended up at Jensen Beach. And it says first annual there, but that was the only one. Do it again. Hooters is expensive. And then this is another collaborative experience this summer with this group Paintalica. Like they're just a bunch of people around the country that get together and paint, and they create these like giant sort of like spectacular types of installations. And at some point I got sick of painting, so it's like I was just thinking about different things to do, and I got an iPad and I was like, yeah, I like being in bed, so I'm just gonna draw in bed for a while. So these are some like digital drawings in bed. And trying out different things too, like I was participating in a teenage art camp. And for a while I was like thinking about like things to do aside from painting, and I was like, oh, like you really enjoyed doing reductive drawings when you were in art school, so maybe you should try to do reductive drawings. And I would just move the eraser around, and what ended up coming out of them were like these like dopey looking high school students, which was great because like I feel like the subject matter relates really well to the material, like using a kneaded eraser and how awkward that is because it's such an imprecise tool. This was me at a costume party at this residency, Skowhegan, and I dressed up as this sculpture by Kiki Smith called Tail, which is just a sculpture of like a figure that has a trail of poop running behind it. But that's kind of turned into like something that's interesting for my teaching practice too. So it's like when I teach 3D design, we end up talking about like scale and proportion, and I make them do these like large scale sculptures out of like tape and paper and aluminum foil. And then we have an exhibition about it in a parking lot. And then this one was Kiki Smith in a football field. And then that's kind of like turned into like sort of projects that exist outside. So I want to make more of those sculptures and just leave them in the mix. See where they end up. And then I've also been doing like animations now that I've been working on the iPad. Like I'm really fascinated with this idea that like, so it's like all these news reporters are like talking about ayahuasca art, like art that you make after like an intense psychedelic experience, and it's like, oh, why aren't news reporters talking about that? That seems so much more interesting than a cat that's like stuck in a tree. There's a few others. And then the last one, that project that I'm going to talk about is a project that doesn't exist yet, but it's happening in Pioneer Square in Portland on November 18th through the 20th, called Sad Park, which is essentially like a temporary mock-up of an indoor seasonal affective disorder park. So it's like a park for seasonal depression. And the idea is that, you know, like we like this idea that it's like, oh, like parks sort of like imitate nature, but like we're interested, like me and my collaborator Ariana Jacob, like we're interested in this idea of like designing a park specifically for like a particular regional psychological landscape. In this case, it's like about seasonal depression. So we're doing this event where it's like, it's just a tent blaring with lights in the middle of November. And we're gonna have like, I guess different events like Tai Chi, and we're gonna have like an herbalist talk possibly. We're gonna have like a puppy petting sort of event, just different types of things in the course of those 3 days. So that's my talk. Thank you. Do you guys have any questions?
Yeah.
So I wanted to ask you, I didn't hear you say it, but a couple of things. Maybe I've said this to you before, but your paintings always kind of reminded me of Al Jaffe from Mad Magazine, of the Mad Holdens.
Yeah.
You see those?
Yeah.
And for years I've always wanted to take your paintings and kind of fold it and see what would happen. But what I wanted to bring up, all your paintings are the same size.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And you do them like
not right now, but I mean, yeah, like usually, like if I'm working through stuff, like I'm usually working on 15 paintings at the same time, and some of them, like, you know, get finished in 2 days, some of them get finished in 3 months, some of them years. So it's It just depends on what seems interesting to work on at the time. But I like that process because it keeps things sort of interesting and, like, I guess less predictable. But in terms of, like, that scale, like, I think I've been thinking about that a lot too, in terms of, like, a painter who's, like, super expressive like that versus, like, a painter that does a lot of that, and, like, what that says about how, like, that painter's body wants to move, and, like, how that type of movement embodies a sense of history. But I don't want to go into that too much. Yes.
Yeah. So you seem to have made a decision pretty late in life to be an artist. Mm-hmm. What advice would you give to somebody struggling with the idea of being an artist or having, you know, a quote real job?
Versus having a quote real job?
Yeah, like how did the decision of like you didn't start making art until grad school, right?
Yeah.
How did you make that decision?
For me,
it just felt like it made sense. I was going through community college for about 2 years. And then at some point I was like, I gotta get out of California, so I moved to Oregon. And from there, it's like I just took different classes, and I took a drawing class and fell in love with it. And so it's like, it just felt good. So it's like, I just wanted to feel good. And so it made sense. Like, it, for me, it was just like following what my body felt and hoping that things turn out for the best. But the thing that, you know, in terms of like deductive, like, reducing it to like a different way of thinking about it, I would also think about like the amount of like engineers and like business people out there that are having a hard time finding work because it's like they don't know themselves well enough to sort of like know that it's like that's the thing for them. So it's like, it's just about like, I guess the best advice would be is like, get to know yourself and get to know like how you want to function out in the world. Like, take a subject position. Like, oftentimes with art school, a lot of, I think, students get taught to sort of like sit in like a confusing type of liminal space, like a place of in-betweenness. So it's like that image creates meaning. But I think it's actually more important to sort of like take a stand for something. Does that make sense? I don't know if I answered your question.
Yeah.
All of your art seems to be about melding together ideas and taking something everyone knows and turning it unexpected. What thought process do you use to come up with stuff like that?
I don't know.
Why is it so interesting?
I think it's just about like knowing what goes through your mind and like not being afraid to just kind of like express it, even if you think it's dumb. I think my work's dumb all the time, but I think the process of recognizing that, like actually, and like really thinking through those thoughts, like it's been very beneficial for me. Because like for me, it's like about acknowledging that those things exist as opposed to sort of like denying them. And it's like that then goes into like a super therapeutic route, which is like just a terrible thing. You know, it's like, because it's like nobody wants to talk about your baggage or like your therapy. But it's like if you're going through your art knowing that you have something to express, and then like you know that expression has a social function in some way, because like you're, for whatever reason, I think that's good.
I would agree. I love all of this.
Cool. Thanks. Yeah.
So I really love how you have such a vast like set of different matrices, if you will, that you know, whether it's like different centuries, different cultures, different ideas that you think, you know, you paint, and then you also like do activities too, and then you involve the public. You just have a lot of different variations. Really awesome. For me, that's what I'm wondering is with painting, I guess, specifically, because I really like art, to take different types of paintings like that. Like, if you were to tell somebody starting out who wanted to focus on art as a career, or like, you know, then what would you tell them in regards to how to like put where what kind of resources would you get your art noticed? I guess what I'm saying.
It's your community, it's like the people that are around you. Because it's like those are the people that obviously are in the same place as you for a reason. And those are the people that you would probably get and would get you, and like those are the people you would touch, I think. So I think being active in your community is actually really good. Like, so maybe it's about like starting out your own organization and like coming up with something, because it's like, yeah, even as like if you don't exist within this institution after you get out of school, like at least you know that it's like you can activate yourself to create something out of nothing. And it's always good to go out into the world, not coming from a passive position where you're just like hoping to be discovered, but it's like you're contributing to something and like you're moving things forward no matter what. It was Asiatsu. So it's like this woman was like holding onto some beams on the ceiling, and it was like massaging me with her feet, basically, is what it was. But it was really intense, like super visceral. Yeah, I've never had a lucid dream before. It was fascinating. Thank you, guys.